Hello. Today we're going to talk about the adaptive immune system and specifically focus on cellular immunity. So cellular immunity is all about T cells. This is a T cell right here, and it's attacking a cancerous body cell. And it's called cellular immunity because living cells are providing the protection. We can contrast that with humoral immunity, which is all about antibodies. So the cellular immune response is more varied than the humoral. So we're going to have different kinds of effector T cells, some of them that actually directly kill other cells, and other ones that release chemicals that are going to control the immune response. If you remember that B cells target extracellular pathogens, that would mean like a virus floating in lymph, T cells do the exact opposite. So T cells target intracellular pathogens and cancerous cells. So body cells, if they've been infected by viruses or bacteria, cancerous or other ways abnormal body cells, and also foreign cells. Like if we get a transplant, we don't have our self antigen, so our body recognizes them as foreign and attacks them. B cells and antibodies, T cells can't see antigens. This means that we have to present the antigen to them on an antigen-presenting cell in order to be able to activate the T cell. You might remember me mentioning that, and MHC, major histocompatibility complex, might sound familiar. Those are the proteins that the antigens attach to for presentation. Today we're going to go a little bit deeper into MHC proteins, and we're going to talk about the difference between class 1 and class 2. So class 1 MHC, this is what we already talked about. And every single cell in your body, except for red blood cells, is going to have a class 1 MHC protein, and this is what your self-antigen, like it marks your cell as one of your body cells. Class 1 MHC proteins display endogenous antigens. Endo means from the inside, so they're fragments of proteins that were synthesized inside of the cell. So normally, that is a self-antigen. Our body cell makes its own antigen, but a body cell could also get infected, and then whatever pathogen infected it could actually be displayed on its surface. So sometimes class 1 MHC proteins can display non-self antigens as well. Here's a little diagram of that. So class 1 MHC means that it has to be endogenous. And that would be our normal MHC complex. And then the self antigen. Here is a cell that's been infected. And then we can see it's displaying the self antigen, but also a little bit of the foreign antigen as well. So if a cell were to see this, they would be alarmed. They would recognize it like, hey, something is wrong. We gotta call in the immune system. Class 2 MHC proteins. So these are rare. These are only going to be found on antigen-presenting cells. Those are dendritic cells, macrophages, and B cells. And class 2 MHC proteins display exogenous antigens, if so, from the outside. So they're going to display antigens that they did not personally make. Instead, they would consume a pathogen and then display little fragments of it on its surface. Diagram is that as well. And the purpose of a class 2 MHC is that T cells have this like kind of weakness where they can't see antigens unless they're being presented. We need a class 2 MHC protein to be able to show the T cell what the antigen looks like. So now let's talk about how T cells get activated. It starts with antigen presentation. So over here is a dendritic cell, and we can see that it's going to engulf this bacteria. It's going to digest it, and then it's going to display fragments of the bacteria on its MHC protein. after the antigen-presenting cell presents an antigen, the T cell has to go through two rounds of recognizing it. So first, it has to recognize the antigen MHC complex. So over here, this blue thing is our T cell, and this rectangle is the T cell receptor. The purple cell is our dendritic cell, and the purple rectangle is the class 2 MHC protein. And it's holding a red antigen. In this case, that would be a non-self, like bacterial antigen. So notice that the T cell is binding to the purple rectangle and to the antigen. That is one half of the double recognition. This is a protein that's on the surface of the T cell that aids in it binding the antigen MHC complex. It's kind of helping hold the MHCs together there. The second step of the double recognition is called co-stimulation. So another protein on the surface of the T cell has to be able to bind with a protein on the surface of an antigen-presenting cell. If we don't have both steps, nothing will happen. And if we do happen to bind the self-non-self complex and the co-stimulatory molecule, then the T cell becomes activated and it starts multiplying. And depending on which cytokine, like a chemical messenger, is released, it could make three different kinds of T cells and also will make memory cells like our B cells did. Why do you think the double recognition is so important? Because T cells can actually kill other cells. So we really don't want to activate them by accident. Could you imagine if a T cell got activated by like a class 1 MHC? Because then it would literally start killing all of our body cells. So the fact that it has to recognize the antigen MHC complex and the co-stimulatory molecule, it makes it less likely that it's going to get activated by mistake. Here's an overview of all the different cytokines and what they do. I don't really care about us knowing them, but just being aware that there are a bunch of different interferons and interleukins. Those are like two types of cytokines. Okay, so after a T cell becomes activated, it has the antigen presentation, it has double recognition, then it's going to form memory cells and effector cells. If you remember with humoral immunity, it made memory cells and plasma cells that secreted antibodies. This time, we have three different types of effector cells: helper T cells, cytotoxic T cells, and regulatory T cells. So let's start by talking about helper T cells. Once primed by antigen presentation of an antigen, a helper T cell can help activate B cells and other T cells, can help induce T and B cells to multiply to form their little clone armies, and secrete cytokines that will recruit other immune cells, so secrete those interferons and interleukins, and then also amplify the innate response. So activate macrophages, mobilize lymphocytes and macrophages, and attract other types of white blood cells. So helper T cells do a ton of things. If we don't have helper T cells, we're in big trouble because they're activating B cells, humoral immunity, and T cells, cellular immunity. So they absolutely control adaptive immunity, and they can even improve our innate immunity. And this is illustrated very well because AIDS is the result of not having helper T cells. Here is a diagram where we can see kind of the different roles of helper T cells. So here, the helper T cell is blue, and notice that it is releasing cytokines to be able to activate the B cell. So I didn't say this before, but the B cell, it can't just like bind with its antigen and then start producing antibodies. It does have to bind with a helper T cell first, and then it will be stimulated to divide and start producing antibodies. So if you do not have helper T cells, then you have no humoral response at all. Over here, helper T cells in cellular immunity. So here are helper T cells, blue again, and here is a purple dendritic cell binding to another type of T cell. And notice that again, the helper T cell is releasing cytokines that are helping to activate the T cell. So it has to have the double recognition with the antigen MHC complex and the co-stimulatory molecule and the antigens from the helper T cells. Oops, I said antigens, I meant cytokines. So if you don't have helper T cells, you essentially have no cellular immunity because this is needed to create our cytotoxic and our regulatory T cells. And then I added part C down here just to remind you about how helper T cells can amplify innate immunity by activating macrophages. Cytotoxic T cells. These are the ones that kill other cells. They can directly attack and kill them. Activated cytotoxic T cells circulate in blood and lymph and lymphoid organs in search of body cells displaying an antigen that they recognize. Specifically, they're going to target virus-infected cells. Cells with intracellular bacteria or parasites, cancer cells, or foreign cells, perhaps from a transplant. So they're targeting pretty much the opposite thing of what the B cells are going to target, which is good because it's kind of like we cover all our bases. How do cytotoxic T cells kill other cells? It's a two-step process. Step number one, T cells are going to release chemicals called perforins and granzymes. The perforins create pores through which granzymes can enter the target cell, and then once the granzymes enter, they cause apoptosis. Cytotoxic T cells can also bind to an external membrane on an external receptor on the cell membrane and stimulate apoptosis that way. So, two different ways to accomplish the same thing. Here is an image of that happening. So, here we have our cytotoxic T cell, and then this yellow cell must be like a cancerous body cell. So, the T cell is going to release perforins, which kind of like the complement proteins, they're able to bind to the cell and they create small pores. And then the granzymes, so the perforins are like the long kind of stick-like things. The granzymes are these little circles. The granzymes are able to enter the cell through the perforins and then cause apoptosis to happen. And here we can see another image of an actual cytotoxic T cell and a cancer. Remember that cytotoxic T cells can only see antigens on MHC proteins. Natural killer cells can recognize other signs of abnormality that cytotoxic T cells do not look for, such as cells that lack class 1 MHC proteins, antibodies coating a target cell, different surface markers seen on stressed out cells. Natural killer cells can use the same mechanisms as cytotoxic T cells for killing their target cells. This is called immune surveillance. The fact that cytotoxic T cells and natural killer cells are able to see different types of cells. So basically, they cover each other because each one can see something that the other one can't see. So, as an example, let's say that you have a bacteria and it is floating by the T cell. It will literally like just float right by the T cell. The T cell cannot see a pathogen. It can only see antigens on antigen-presenting cells. However, the natural killer cell is going to see the cell, it's going to feel it, and it's kind of feel for the MHC class 1, like the self antigen. And if it doesn't find it, it will kill it. Nice complementarity for death. Our final category of effector T cells are regulatory T cells. Their job is to basically shut the immune system off after we've dealt with the problem. because the body, like, we don't want to keep on releasing signals to cause inflammation after it's no longer helpful. So regulatory T cells secrete inhibitory cytokines to be able to stop the process. Regulatory T cells are important in preventing autoimmune reactions, because an autoimmune reaction is when your body attacks itself. And normally your regulatory T cells should stop that before it becomes like an autoimmune disease. Suppress self-reactive lymphocytes in the periphery outside the lymphoid organs, so traveling through the circulatory system in the lymphatics. And then they're also an area of study, because what if when we did an organ transplant, we could turn off someone's regulatory T cells? Would we be able to use that to force the person to be able to accept the transplanted tissue? It's an idea, something to think about. Okay, that is a wrap on cellular immunity. Please let me know what questions you still have.